Students, now we will discuss about the shear testing using unconfined compression testing apparatus, and also we will do a triaxial shear testing using a triaxial shear apparatus. Now, incidentally, we can use this triaxial shear apparatus and the loading frame, which is to the side, we will show you the loading frame. We can use the same loading frame for doing the unconfined compression test. What is an unconfined compression test? It is a test where we don't have any confinement. It can be used for clay specimens where it has got cohesion, therefore there is no need for confinement. We cannot do unconfined compression test, in short, which is called UCC test, cannot do it for sands. We need some confinement, therefore we never use this. But triaxial can be used both for sand as well as for clays. But for sand, we need lot of precaution and method to prepare the specimen. It's very difficult, but still we can do it. We can do either a compression test or an extension test. But for your syllabus, we have got only compression test. For research purpose, we do extension test, which is not within your purview. Now we will see what this is. The shear apparatus, that is the triaxial shear apparatus. It has got a base plate, we got a pedestal here, and we have got four valves, the four directions perpendicular to each other. And we have got a cell which will be mounted like this. Now this has got a perspex cylinder which can have a capacity for taking the cell pressure up to 10 kg per cm square or 100,000 kPa. Now each 1 kg per cm square is equal to 100 kPa. Now we have got a piston here. This is the piston. It should be properly grease, so that you should not use grease. Actually, you should oil it so that it can have a smooth movement. Now, the preparation of the specimen. Now, why you need these four walls? Okay, one is for the entry of the water into this cell, and when you prepare the specimen, we are going to use that water pressure for the confinement, which is called the cell pressure. Now, we will discuss more about the how the specimen is prepared. Now usually we prepare an undisturbed sample. Then now we usually use a piston tube, because this is a Shelby tube which is driven into the soil sample in the field, and we are going to extract it using the tongs, and it is removed and it is brought to the laboratory. It will be actually sealed at both the top and bottom. We have got a bevel edge at this bottom so that we can drive it easily. This is used for soft soils or clays or specimens where you can drive this. We have to use hydraulic pressure, we should not drive it, okay? Actually, we have to push it. We have to push this undisturbed sampler, and we have to collect the samples. Now, so one such sample which is obtained, for example, it has been obtained and it is brought to the laboratory. We are going to remove the wax which is at the end, and we are going to use this. This is a soil extruder. We are going to place this sample. Okay, this is the sampler. This can be split open so that we can extrude the soil sample. Now this tube has to be placed here. We're going to place this tube here, and we are going to turn it so that we thrust open the sample, and we are going to collect it in this tube. Now we are going to place this tube here, and we are going to drive it so that the sample comes through this portion and it comes here. Then I can use a wire here, there will be a wire actually. We can cut it, then we can remove this. Actually, this will be tightened. Later, I can loosen this again, and I can just give some tamping so that it becomes loose, and I can just press using a wooden mallet. Okay, it comes out. Now, I can take that and I can cut it to the required size. Now, usually, we use a sample which is 38 mm in diameter and 76 mm in height. The height to diameter ratio is always maintained too. Now this is the pedestal on which you are going to place this sample. At the bottom, you are going to have a porous stone. You got arrangements for measuring the pore water pressure and also to find out what is the volume change. Now we are going to place this porous stone, and at the bottom you are going to have either if you are doing a undrained test, you are going to place it with a, instead of a porous stone, I am going to place a plain perspex sheet so that the water doesn't drain out. Now we have got drainage conditions. Triaxial shear test has got a lot of advantage in the sense that we can have a very good control over the drainage conditions. Now regarding the, in short about the drainage conditions, there are three stages of testing. First stage of doing the triaxial shear test is the saturation stage, which is common to all the varieties of this triaxial shear testing. Then the next two stages, one is called the consolidation stage. In the consolidation stage, we can keep the drainage valve open or it can be closed. And the last stage is the shearing stage. In the shearing stage, we can keep the drainage valve open or closed. Depending upon that, we got three types of shear testing and the three types of drainage conditions. Now we will try to discuss about, usually for a laboratory, we are going to do only a unconsolidated undrained test. More details about the drainage conditions and all those things have been recorded in another video lecture, which will be uploaded along with this information. You can go through that video, you will get a lot of information about the drainage conditions. Now let us say we are doing unconsolidated undrained test. I am going to use how to place this. Now once I place this specimen, I need to place this cell, and when I place this cell here, what is going to happen? You are going to allow the water to enter. Now the water is going to come and apply pressure, all round pressure. Now water should not disturb the specimen in terms of the required saturation. Therefore what I am going to do, I am going to use a membrane. A rubber membrane is surrounding the soil specimen that has to be protected. Now what I am going to do, I am going to use a rubber membrane and I am going to suck this, and when I suck this and I place it, when I suck it, what happens? The rubber membrane, which is having a lot of slackness, when I suck it, what happens? It gets retracted inside and it will be having sufficient space so that I can slide it past here, and I can, now let me do that. Now once I suck it, okay, I can easily slide it. Now then I am going to open up this. At the top again I am going to place one more perspex sheet. Then at the top I am going to have, now we have to place the O-ring here so that the ingress of water can be prevented. Both at the bottom, there is a groove placed, given, there is a provision of the groove at the bottom and at the top. Now let us see how we are using this membrane structure. I am going to use this rubber O-ring. It will be very tight and you need to be very careful in placing it position. Place one ring at the top and one at the bottom. Now I can slide it here and have to take it to the position, and now it has gone to the groove. Start, Mudra.
Ready.
Now we have to place the load cell and we have to push the piston so that the piston is touching the groove placed at the top loading pan. Now we have to use this screws. Place them in a loose way in the opposite directions, and when you tighten it, you have to tighten the diagonal screws. Now this is the portion where you can place your, this is the projection given, so that I place my dial gauge to note down the my axial strain. Now this is the load frame for the traction. We have got the similar turret element and the maintaining the strain rate. Okay, we can adjust depending upon my required strain rate. I can take different turret positions. And now we have got four valves, and we are going to use appropriate valves for sending the water inside. Pump, okay, we have water. Sometimes we have oil also. We can use oil for maintaining the cell pressure, or we can use water through the pump. Okay, you are going to use your foot and you are going to apply this pressure, and you have got a gauge which is going to indicate what is the pressure that is required and what is maintained there. Now Prakash is going to explain to you how you are going to place this connection and see that water is supplied through one wall, and how the cell pressure through the water is applied. All round pressure, you are going to get your all round pressure to the sample. And once you start shearing, okay, once it starts moving, okay, you have got an air vent here. You have got to remove the air. Okay, when the water is supplied through one of the wall, water has to come out through this. And once the water is ensured that water has gone without any air, then therefore there is no air inside, and I am going to close the wall. Then I am going to close the wall which was used for supplying the water inside the cell. Once this is closed, I am going to make all the arrangements such that I have got the contact, and this is the probing ring, and I have got the this is the dial gauge from mounting on the axial.
Preliminary setup takes a little bit more time for generally for a triaxial shear test when compared to other shear tests. But here the advantage of this particular test is one can have the reliable shear strength parameters from the experiment. So different drainage conditions, that depends upon the one who is doing the experiment basically. All three drainage conditions, it is possible here. Nowadays, the one more drainage, fourth one is included to the earlier three drainage conditions. But generally, what we are doing is UU test, unconsolidated underground test. The specimen is not subjected to consolidation, and also not we are not going to drain the material. Such a type of test is termed as unconsolidated underground test. Similar to this, what we are having that unconfined compression test. Here, addition is the hydrostatic stress which is applying over this sample, which is encased with the membrane. What we can see here inside. So this is a triaxial testing apparatus, compression testing apparatus. With all these things, so two things we have to observe. It is thrust, it is actually loaded here, that is from the probing ring. Other observation is from this there, that is the displacement. One more is that the strain rate, that depends upon the one who is doing the experiment. He can select these any one of these. So that will be convenient. Strain rate is 1.2 mm per minute, what we are using for this particular test. It can be reduced or else it can be increased depending upon the case of study. So this is the initial setup for commencing the observation. So before sitting on the machine, and these two dials are brought to zero, and after one has applied the sitting load. Sitting load in the sense, this has to be in contact with the specimen. So that is the meaning of applying the sitting load for commencing the observation.
Now using the foot pump, okay, is supplying water. Now it is entering into the cell. Now once this cell is filled with water, it has to come out, okay, so that whatever air is inside has to be expelled. Now once you get the water without any air, then you are going to close both the, these are the two air vents. They have to be closed. Now they are open. Now we can close this. We have closed both the air vents, and also this has been closed. Now we can wipe extra water, whatever has fallen, and we can use a cotton waste or
a towel and clean it. Okay. Though it's not going to obstruct us, okay, it is going to give an ambience for working, so that when you're recording, it may not spill onto your sheet. Now, gear selection. Now, depending upon the type of soil, whether it is a clay, it's a very soft clay, which is very fat clay, which builds up pore water pressure. We don't want the pore water pressure to build up. We want to do a very slow strain rate. It depends upon the field condition, how the loading is going to come onto that soil specimen. Depending upon that, to simulate to the field condition, we can choose varied strain rate. Okay, whatever strain rate you're going to choose, that is constant for that particular type of specimen. You're also going to do three identical tests on identical specimens with the varying temperature. Now, Prakash has supplied water, and now he's going to apply the cell pressure, and the cell pressure is we can note down from here, this is some cell pressure, it is at 0.5. Now, based on that cell pressure, I am going to do this test. Okay, now the cell pressure. Now, I am not going to open the drainage wall. Now, whatever water is there, that as which is confining the specimen, has got some pressure. There is an all-round cell pressure at the top, because water is hydraulic and the only hydraulic pressure is uniform throughout. In any direction, it will have the same pressure. Therefore, at the top and the bottom and at the sides, everywhere we will have the all-round pressure of the whatever cell pressure we are maintaining the dial gauge in the foot pump. The pressure gauge, not dial gauge, the pressure gauge. Now, I am going to start the motor, and it is going to raise, the platform is going to raise at a strain rate chosen. Okay, now the turret position is at 1. Now, when it is at 1, the position 1, it is going to give a strain rate of 6 mm per minute. Now, whether I want it or not, okay, I can change it to a different position. It depends upon our requirement. Now, I am going to start this experiment. I am going to note down the dial gauge readings. At regular, I am going to adjust this dial gauge reading to 0, and at regular intervals of dial gauge reading, I am going to take the reading taken by the probe ring. That is nothing but the axial load. That is the deviated load. That is the additional load in the vertical direction, axial direction, and that is going to be added to the cell pressure. That gives your major principal stress sigma 1.
So, before commencing the observation, these two dials are required to bring it to 0. Dial gauge and also this it's of the observations for plotting that graph of shear stress for having the shear strength parameters. So we can select required strain rate here, 7 for 2 that indicates 1.25 mm per minute. So generally what we are going to I'm going to switch on the machine. Most the pedestal will move according to this strain rate. Every certain periods here, what is the corresponding reading from the preliminary reading? That is the observation. Till we are satisfied with the observation. That means specimen when it fails, even after that, a few observations, 5 to 10 readings that is required for filling the table.
Students, you will have to observe here that we are taking regular intervals of the axial strain. There is an axial strain, this is moving in upward direction. Now, we use the button which is giving up, it is mentioned here up, and this is for down after conducting this one. Now, this is moving in the upward direction, it is getting sheared, okay, in the axial direction. Okay, it is shear stress is applied in the vertical direction or in the axial direction. Now, at regular intervals of the strain, maybe 10 divisions, 20 divisions, 30 divisions, 40 divisions, like this up to 100 you can take, similar to what we did in direct here. At regular intervals, at the closer intervals, we are going to take the readings in the initial part, and we are going to take what is the dial gauge reading of the proving ring. This can be converted to the axial load by using the proving ring constant. We will have a calibration chart, because every time our laboratory staff will get it calibrated, and we will have a calibration chart indicating what is the load taken by the indicated by the proving ring. Now, this has to be continued till the readings increase, go to a peak value, and it starts receding back. some 5 or 6 readings of the receding portion should be taken. That indicates the residual stress state after reaching the peak. Now, in certain samples which are very, very stiff, which are fatless, it will never fail. It will never go to the peak and it will never come back. It keeps on increasing. It will never fail. Therefore, for such kind of specimens, what we do is, your length of the specimen is 76 mm. Or 76 mm means, or 7.6 cm, 20% of that length. 20% of the length is 7.6 mm into 2, that is 15.2 mm. Once it moves 15.2 mm, now it can convert into 15.2 mm into number of divisions in the axial listing. Now up to that stage you can take the reading, then you can stop. Otherwise what happens, leads to the deformation of all the thing and it is not required. Therefore we take the load which is indicated at 20% axial strain as the peak axial load, and you are going to stop the experiment. Now what is the use of this data? You are going to use it. You are going to plot axial stress versus axial strain, and we are going to get a stress strain curve. Any material which is subjected to strain, it is undergoing strain, means it offers some resistance. Therefore it is the load deformation behavior of this soil material, or it may be any engineering material. That load deformation behavior curve is going to give us the peak axial stress taken. That gives the axial stress or the deviated stress. That deviated stress has to be used in your plotting of your failure envelope. Now using that, okay, you can add whatever cell pressure I have maintained. For example, first trial I am maintaining a cell pressure of 50 kPa or 0.5 kg per cm square. If your sigma 3 or the cell pressure sigma C or sigma 3 is equal to 50 plus this axial stress, okay, will use my conversion of the growing ring reading, I am going to add it, I get my major principal stress. Now I got my major principal stress, I got my minor principal stress, sigma 3 and sigma 1 for the first trial. Now using this sigma 3 and sigma 1, I am going to plot my Mohr circle. Similarly, I am going to do another two trials with identical specimens and I get my another two Mohr circles. Now using those three Mohr circles, I draw a tangent. What is the condition? That the Mohr theory tells that when you plot the Mohr circle at failure, the Mohr circle is tangential to the failure angle. Therefore, beyond that you won't have don't have a stable condition, it is going to be a failure condition. Therefore, at failure, the Mohr circle is going to be tangential to the failure angle. Therefore, I draw a tangent touching all the three Mohr circles, and that defines your the failure envelope, which is a approximated straight line or a two-dimensional thing. Now, when you trace it backwards, it intercepts the y-axis. That gives your cohesion intercept. Now, using that cohesion intercept and the slope of the failure envelope gives you your angle of interception. Fine. Now, students will have to understand, you can do a test with the different drainage conditions. Now, since you are doing a unconsolidated undrained test, which is called UU test in short, which is a quick test which requires not more than 5 minutes. Now, we can do here, you are not measuring any pore water pressure. See, there is a problem for measuring pore water pressure. You are not draining out the pore water pressure. Therefore, you have got whatever stress is the total stress. Therefore, your Mohr circle which is plotted and the failure envelope and your the shear parameters are total stress parameters. You get C and phi, not C dash and phi dash. Now we can do different drainage conditions. You can do similar test using different drainage conditions. If I do in the first stage when I apply the cell pressure, if I open the drainage wall, I am not going to go to the second stage of shearing. I allow the consolidation pressure to drain out to consolidate the soil sample. That is called the consolidation stage. After consolidating, I am going to close the drainage wall. I am going to shear up. And during the shearing stage, similar to what I am doing here, I am not going to keep the drainage wall open. That indicates a undrained test. Therefore, you got a unconsolidated undrained test, you got a consolidated undrained test, and in the third type of test, when I apply the cell pressure, I open the drainage wall, I consolidate the sample. Then during the shearing stage also, I open the drainage wall and see that no pore water pressure is developed at any stage. Therefore, I am going to place my direct position in such a strain that moment there is a pore water pressure built up, it is going to get dissipated. Therefore, you are going to do at a very, 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 very slow standard, and for a fat clays or a very high expansive clays or even very stiff clays or which are having high plasticity, you require not more less than 10 to 15 days to do one trial. Therefore, it is a very slow test. Therefore, you have got a UU test, which is a quick test which requires 5 minutes. You got a consolidated undead test, which is called a rapid test, which requires at least one day, because you need to do the consolidation, which requires at least half a day or more than at least minimum of a day, and it may extend to one day. After the consolidation is over, shearing may take another 5-10 minutes. Therefore, it is called a rapid test. And in a third type of test, is called the consolidated drain test, which is called the CD test, which requires a long time. It is a very, very slow test. Therefore, it is called designated slow test. Therefore, in the alphabetical rhyming this thing, you got this is called the quick test, PQRSQ test. Then the second one is called the R test, and the third test is called the slow test or the S test. Therefore, QRS, quick test, rapid test, and slow test. These tests are the drainage conditions are maintained to simulate to the field conditions. Now, where do you use this undrain test? Okay, which is in the short form called U test, is also called undrain test. The undrain test is used for short-term stability checks. For example, I want to mobilize a construction equipment to the field. There you got a soft clay, you got a very, clay which doesn't have much strength. Then if I mobilize the construction equipment, maybe an excavating equipment, then suddenly what happens, the pore water pressure is built up and it is not going to bear that load, it is going to lead to collapse. Therefore, I can do a test of the sample from the field, I can do a test and I can ascertain what is the load taken by the soil sample? Can I mobilize my equipment? Or I need to do some ground improvement so that this equipment can be mobilized. Or it may be construction of an embankment. Immediately after construction, before it is loaded, you can do the construction stage itself. I want to check what is the short-term stability. Immediately after it's loaded, its own self-weight. It has not consolidated. Only in its self-weight only it may fail. Therefore, I can look into the short-term stability by using a UU test. Now, where do you use a consolidated undrain test, that is called the second test, which is the rapid test or CU test. CU test is used for stage loading, where you apply some load, you got some time for consolidation, and that so that the load is transferred and the pore water pressure is dissipated, then you go for the next stage of loading. Therefore, when you got a staged construction, I am going to use consolidated undrain test. It is only to simulate what is going to happen in the field, I am going to do it in the laboratory. Then we got finally the consolidated drain test. When you want to go for the long-term stability checks, about the embankment, what is going to be the performance of the embankment, what is the factor of safety, how many folds it is going to improve from the short-term condition to the long-term condition, long-term stability checks I can use by doing CD test. Therefore, these are all the tests which are done for our convenience, and you need to use your judgment to match with the field conditions. Now look here, it is still increasing. Sample, and also you can observe when the sample starts getting compressed, there is a change in cross section area. You need to make the cross section area changes so that when you find out your stress, that is the axial stress, your corrected cross section area may have to be used. How to get your axial stress? You have got your preliminary reading, which gives the axial load, which is P divided by the cross section area, which is corrected AC. AC is equal to the original cross section area, A0 divided by 1 minus of epsilon. Epsilon is delta L by L. Delta L is your change in your axial length divided by the length of the specimen. The length of the specimen is 76 mm, and the change in length is indicated by the change in the dial gauge reading. One can prepare a chart, one can also prepare an Excel sheet, you can go on feeding all these things, and the corrected cross section area can be incorporated. You can have a macros introduced, and you can just pull down, you get all your calculations of your axial strain and your axial stress. Once you have these things, you can use the Excel sheet and you can try to get your peak stress. You can plot the stress strain curve also using that Excel. One should learn, okay, we will give you more details how we can plot this data. We will give you some typical data of your axial stress and axial strain, and how to calculate it. We will put all this information in your website. You can use that information, which will be self-explanatory. Once you find that it is reached your peak stress and it starts receding, can stop the experiment. Receding stages, when the decreasing reading takes place, you can take some 4-5 readings to ensure that it is in the receiving phase or the residual stress stage. Since this is a sample which is prepared in the laboratory, it's a removed specimen, which is a partly solid specimen, it will take a lot of load. Therefore, this is not it, because I missed the first stage, it is called the saturation stage. Saturation, the sample has to be saturated, that has to be done by back pressure saturation. There is a technique, we will explain you the PPT and other details, we will give on how using the back pressure you are going to saturate the specimen. Before saturation you cannot do it, because saturation condition is the, because you need to test the soil for the worst condition. In the field, the saturated condition is the worst stage and you have to do for the saturated condition. And this will be explained in your video. Already I have sent you the theory class, already I have sent you the videos. Okay, once again we can give you all these details, and also we'll attach with the PowerPoint presentation which gives a lot of details, and the write up also will be given so that you can prepare all those information and you can have your own notes. We will stop here because it takes a lot of things, it's not worth conducting, because you need to stop at a 20% diagonal strain. Stop on. This is a typical triangle shear test for a UV test. Similar shearing will be done for all the drainage conditions, whether it is a UV test or a CUV test or a CD test. Shearing is common, and you saw how the cell pressure is applied, that is a common thing. But the additional thing is that when you are doing the consolidation in the initial stage, when you apply the cell pressure, we need to open the drainage valve, one of the drainage valve will open, so that the pore pressure, you will have to connect. There are some valves there, you need to connect from the top to the bottom so that it is connected to the drainage valve, so that when the water gets when the water which is confining the soil specimen, it starts squeezing, it consolidates the soil sample under this confining pressure. All that water gets squeezed out, and you can ensure that the soil has been consolidated by finding out the A parameter and B parameter. The stem terms, pore pressure parameters called A parameters and B parameters. B parameter is going to give A parameter is going to give you the degree of consolidation, or the, sorry, not degree of consolidation, degree of ore consolidation. OCR ratio can be found out. If it is a ore consolidated sample, we will have a very high A parameter, and if it is a normal consolidated, it will be 1. For B parameter is going to give you the degree of saturation. By finding out what is the change in power pressure, okay, we have got the procedure how to find out that B parameter. If B parameter comes very near to 1, that ensures that you have consolidated and the sample is also saturated. After ensuring that it has reached 1, we can go for the shearing stage. These are the general stages. Since it is part of your syllabus that you are going to do only the UV test, therefore we have given all the information regarding UV test. The other additional tests, that the drainage conditions are for CU and CD test, are not required for you. But as an understanding, we will give all the information. Already I have told you what you mean by the CU test and CD test, which is the rapid test and the slow test, and also I have given the field situations. Now in the same apparatus, instead of using this cell pressure, I just place the specimen without the rubber membrane. I just place the rubber membrane, sample, and I place the piston and I make all the arrangements. The similar way, without any confining pressure, if I do an axial compression test, uniaxial compression test, is nothing but an unconfined compression test, which is called the UCC test. This type of test is meant for a saturated clay, because for sand you cannot confine it. So in a saturated clay, you don't need confinement, and when you plot the stress strain curve, you get your value of the peak stress, which is nothing but the UCC value, that is the unconfined compression value, which is called QU. QU is nothing but your major principal stress. In the UCC test, you don't have the all-round confining pressure, therefore sigma 3 is 0 and sigma 1 is equal to your QU value. Therefore, I can plot once the specimen fails, okay, you will have the failure plane, okay, you can take the specimen, you place it on a plane sheet, and you find out what is the angle of that failure plane. That if it is a saturated specimen, clay specimen, your angle alpha of the failure plane with respect to the horizontal will be exactly 45 degrees. If it is slightly saturated, means it may be 95% saturated, the degree of saturation is 95 or 98, what happens, you may get a slight increased angle of
that failure angle. It may be slightly more than 45 degrees. It may be 48 or 46 or 49. Based on that, okay, now you know alpha is equal to, the failure angle is equal to 45 degrees plus pi by 2. From that you can find out your angle of inclination, that is angle of internal friction phi on that failure angle. Okay, and other things you can refer to the video, how to use this observations that you are going to get from your laboratory testing, how to plot the graphs and get your shear parameters, namely C and phi. And one thing you have to remember, students, okay, C is not the cohesion of the sample, it is the cohesion intercept. It is the way how geometrically when you plot the graph, you get your intercept. It is not cohesion. For normally concerned, clay C is 0. That doesn't mean that it doesn't have cohesion. Cohesion by concept is the plasticity property of the material. But the cohesion intercept will be 0, but cohesion can be there for a clay sample.